today is the seventh day of the seventh month on our Maker's Restored calendar. It is the fifth day of September on His servant Satan's calendar. I keep pointing out in these videos how His restored 30-day months are perfectly in sync with the dates and the other waypoint indicators that He gave to us in the testimony of His word. For instance, on this seventh day of the seventh month, we are 3 days' journey from His commanded observance of His Day of Atonement. The way that this is perfectly in sync with His word is it parallels the utmost importance that His word puts upon the seventh day, along with the emphasis that His word puts upon the Feast of Sevens, especially this year's feast that was in this prophetic seventh year of the release, and the emphasis that His word has placed upon His liquidation sale of your belongings that He has brought forth through the testimony of His word in conjunction with this year's Feast of Sevens, along with all of the emphasis that the testimony of His word places upon 3 days and the number three, 3 days' journey in the number three. In lieu of these details and many others, it is not just by chance that the Day of Atonement is 3 days' journey from the seventh day of the seventh month. Nor is it just a random thing that this video that is being sent forth on this seventh day of the seventh month is the first song of three more sweet songs left to go. Nor is it a coincidence that Yahweh's word tells us the following about your blasphemous worship songs. In Amos chapter 8, verse 10, "And I will turn your feast in the morning and all of your songs into lamentation, and I will rise up sackcloth upon all of your dual loins, and baldness will be upon every head, and I will put upon you mourning as for an only child, and your end will be a bitter day." In referring to this song as song number three, I am referring to there being three more videos counting this one that are left to go to the 1005th video waypoint that His word established as a matter of end time prophecy through His servant Solomon's 1005 songs. I do not know where Solomon's 1005 songs are, or if they even still exist at this time, or where the rest of his 3,000 parables and proverbs are, or if they even still exist at this time. However, I do know that 1 Kings chapter 4 telling us that Solomon brought forth these numbers of these things is a matter of end time prophecy. I know this because these numbers fit snugly into the here and the now in an incredible way. I also know that which man breaks forth fades away. However, Yahweh's word endures forever. And since these 1005 videos contain His word that He has put upon my mouth in them, even the ones that He has let me have error in them, I know that the prophecy that He has sent me with will endure forever. And I know that these 1005 videos are a sweet-smelling savor to my Elohim's ears, while only He knows probably millions and millions of songs that you sing to praise your make-believe Elohims, and the rest of the songs that you rejoice in listening to are a stitch in His ears, just like they are a stitch to His nose. And I know that He is soon going to turn your rejoicing in your songs into lamentation. I know this because His word says so. Your feast in this verse is referring to your perversions of His feast by celebrating them when and how your rebellious hearts see fit to observe them, and also to your replacements of His feast with the blasphemous celebrations that you mark each year, like your Mass of your make-believe Messiah and your Easter Bunny celebrations. Sackcloth will be upon your dual loins could have referred to those of you that would have turned back to Him in sackcloth and soil upon you, like our ancestors did on the 24th day of the seventh month when they turned back to His holy mountain. However, at this point, it does not look like there are going to be any others that are going to have turned back to Him, to His holy mountain that He has raised up in our midst by this day point in time this year. So it is referring to those of you that are going to be outside of the walls of Zion weeping because of that which your unbelief has caused to be sent upon you. You could have listened to that which the Most High's writer's inkhorn that is put upon my dual loins has written upon the boulder design of His altar, but you have not done so. Therefore, you are either going to be humbled and put sackcloth upon your dual loins, or you are going to be destroyed from before our Maker's faces. He goes on to tell us the following in Amos chapter 8 and verse 11. Behold, the days come, says Adonai Yahweh, that I will send forth a famine in the land, not a famine of bread, nor of a thirst for waters, but rather of listening to Yahweh's words. And they will wander from sea to sea and from the north to the east, and they will push forth to search after Yahweh's word, and they will not find it. This is what you have been doing instead of listening to this Yahweh's word that is upon his servant Zerubbabel. You listen to his word that he has put upon me with your dual ears, however, you will not do it. He spoke that this was going to be the case in Ezekiel chapter 33. The people come to the entrance, referring to you coming to the entrance of his house by listening to his End Time Son of Adam's videos or reading the text to them on the website, and they set before your faces as my people, and they listen to your words, but they will not do them, because they show much love to Yahweh with their mouths, but their hearts walk after that which they covet. Behold, they love the sound of their pleasant songs and their well-played instruments that they play along with their pleasant songs, and they listen to your words, referring again to you hearing the word that he's put upon my mouth, but they will not do them. And when this comes to pass, when you will not do that which his end-time watchman has spoken for you to do, and behold, it will come to pass, and this has come to pass, then you will know that a prophet has been amongst you. Therefore, you are not really listening. You are only hearing with your dual ears. Your ears remain plugged by the Most High because you will not do that which he has caused me to speak. In the last video, I spoke about how this famine of listening to his word ties in with his two witnesses having the authority to shut up the rain. The rain is symbolic of Yahweh's word coming down from his dual heavens to nourish those whom he gives dual eyes to see and dual ears to hear. But you have not done that which his two anointed sons have spoken for you to do, so he has shut off this rain from you. You search for the rain in vain, not doing so on his terms. His terms are for you to believe his word and to do that which he tells you to do through his servants the prophets. The fact that you do not believe that I am his prophet testifies that you do not believe his word. He goes on to end his Amos chapter 8 prophecy by telling us, in that day the lovely virgins and the choice men will faint for thirst, and those that summon themselves to the transgressions of Samaria, and those that say the Elohim of Dan lives, and the pathway of Beersheba lives, will fall and never rise up again. I can assure you that the Hebrew word for making a pledge or an oath to someone or to do something, being a derivative of the number 7, is not a coincidence. The 10 rods of Israel that were given under Jeroboam's rule became Samaria. This is what Yahweh's word testifies to. And then later, the Most High also exiled the rods of Judah and Benjamin as well, and they became engrafted into Samaria. This is also what his word testifies to. His word testifies to the fact that he scattered the descendants of Israel into the four wings of the earth, and you remain scattered to this day, even the rods of Judah and Benjamin. However, the rod of Dan embraced the traditions of Judaism along the way, and they gradually took on the identity of being the rod of Judah. And Yahweh brought them back to the physical land that is known as Israel today, because at least they obeyed a form of his truth. The Most High showed me this early on, and I have spoken this throughout these videos. And this verse in Amos testifies to this reality. Since Yahweh's word testifies that he gave the scattered descendants of Israel over to the lies of Christianity, lies that he tells us will not give you eternal life in his kingdom, the transgressions of Samaria is referring to this blasphemous religion. And since this verse tells us that the rod of Dan has a different Elohim, they are not under the umbrella of Christianity that is keeping the rain from coming upon you. However, they still have an umbrella as well. Their umbrella is the make-believe Elohim of Judaism. The pathway of Beersheba addresses both of these blasphemous religions, and it also addresses the blasphemous religion of Islam. Beersheba means a well of sevens. Judaism has their perversion of Tikva Sabbath on the seventh day rotation of Saturn's day on their father Satan's calendar. And so do some of the various Christian religions that embrace this erroneous tradition of the wicked men that say that they are Jews but are not and all of the synagogue of Satan. Most of the rest of Christianity have your perversion of his Sabbath on the seven-day rotation of the day of the sun on your father Satan's calendar. Islam has their blasphemous Sabbath on Phrase Day. I can assure you upon the testimony of my father's word that his seventh-day Sabbaths are not on a fixed day of the week on his servant Satan's calendar that is composed of Satan's continual seven-day rotations. Such a Sabbath does not fit into the testimony of Kikwe by Elohim's word. One of the places that such a Sabbath does not fit into the testimony of his word is right here in this Amos chapter 8 prophecy. He tells us, listen to this, you that swallow up the kneading and cause the poor of the land to cease, saying, when will the month pass over so that we can barter victuals, and the Sabbath so that we can open wide the grain, that diminish the ephah and magnify the shekel and pervert the balances with deceit? The month passing over is referring to the Most High's head of the month days that are commanded non-buying and selling days, as are his Sabbath days. A continually rotating seven-day Sabbath does not fit into his words of truth. His truth tells us to celebrate his head of the month days each month. When he tells us to do so, he almost always associates doing so in conjunction with his Sabbath. And there is no possible way to reconcile doing both on a continual seven-day rotation, period. There are a growing number of people that he has called to come out from their whoredoms to him, to be his people, that he has shown this, and they use his luminaries to identify when his Sabbaths are. However, they are now in error because he has restored his 30-day months, and his Sabbaths and the rest of his appointed times are not in sync with his luminaries at this time. They are not in sync with them per his only begotten son's prophecy that no other sign would be given to the wicked and adulterous generation that requires a physical sign at the time of the judgment except for the sign of Jonah. When Yeshua spoke this prophecy, he tied it in with the 3 days and the 3 nights that Jonah was in the belly of the great fish, and the 3 days and the 3 nights that he was in the tomb. The Most High wove 3 tiers of this prophecy into the testimony of his word to testify to his restoration of his 30-day months. The final tier of it was the 3 30-day periods that were on each side of the scattering of the last 1/3 of my hair that he caused me to scatter in order to fulfill his Ezekiel chapter 5 end time son of Adam prophecy. These 2 3 30-day periods of time parallel the 3 bowls of the golden candlestick that are on each wing of the reed of the golden candlestick that the Most High's 2 olive trees are on each side of. In lieu of his 2 witnesses having the authority to shut off the rain, I can assure you that it is not a coincidence that he left his servant Noah and his family on the ark for 330 days after he shut off the rain. Amos chapter 9, Tikva's servant Amos went on to tell us, I saw Adonai stood up upon his altar, and he said, smite the knop, and shake the basins, and grab, as in gain with determination, their head, all of them, and I will slay the last of them with the sword, and he that flees of them will not get fled, and he that slips away of them will not escape. Tikva being stood up upon his altar is referring to the Most High causing his righteousness to be exalted from upon his altar that he is reared up in the midst of Egypt at this time. I guarantee you that his altar is not where he has allowed for the blasphemous dome of the rock to remain standing to this day. His altar is not in the physical land of Israel. It is right here in the chief seat of the scattered descendants of Israel, just like his word told us that it would be. To think that where the Muslim Dome of the Rock stands this day is his holy mountain is nonsense. It is going to be so in the millennium. However, right now his altar is right here upon the parcel of land that his word calls the parcel of land for the decreeing of his judgment, with his pillar by its side, just like his word tells us that it would be. He has caused the borders of his altar and the 3-cubit by 3-cubit apron that encompasses it to be his holy mountain at this time. His word says so. The boulder design of his altar that he calls the boulder design of his house is the stone marker that he has set up in a dry and parched land that he has reared up within the famine of listening to his word. His word says so. In other videos, I've spoken that the Hebrew word for Zion means a stone marker that is in a dry and a parched land. This is a reality that his word testifies to, that you are soon going to be shown, you're soon going to be shown that this reality is true, just like you're going to be shown that the rest of his word is true. And you're going to know that a prophet has been amongst you. The Hebrew word for Knop in this verse is the word that is used to describe the knops that are upon his golden candlestick and the four bowls of his candlestick. Besides being used to describe these knops that are upon the seven bowls of his golden candlestick and the other four bowls of it that his two witnesses are on each side of, and except for three other places where it is used under a different Strong's number to refer to the country of the Philistines and the Caphtorims, this word is only used in two other places. It is used in this verse and in Zephaniah chapter 2. And in both of these two places, it is used in prophecies that are for the here and the now. The Philistines and the Caphtorims were brothers. One of the three places that this word is used to refer to their country is in this same chapter, Amos. It's the same chapter of Amos in verse 7, where the Most High tells us that the scattered descendants of Israel are the same as Ethiopians to him. This parallels his prophecy that is for me having to walk naked and barefoot for 3 years in Ethiopia. I have had to do so a second time per other prophecies, just like my predecessor Elijah had to be fled for 2-3 year periods of time. My second 3 year period is just about up. The way that all of his prophecies fit together like this is incredible. In two of these three places that this word is used to refer to their country, the Most High's word is speaking of bringing forth one of these brothers out from this land to attack and even to destroy other nations, even Israel, as was the case with the Philistines. This is his show, and he uses the just and the unjust to accomplish that which he purposes as he chooses to do so. He rises up and he abases according to what he purposes in doing so. And he uses what he created to do so. He created the Philistines and the Caphtorims just like he created the descendants of Israel. And it is lawful for him to do what he wants with his creation. His sending forth these two brothers parallels the reality that he is soon going to rise up a fierce people to come upon those of you that are of the scattered descendants of Israel at this time. He is going to bring forth a confederacy of heathens upon you. However, the two biggest players in this will be the brothers China and Russia. The other place that this word is used to refer to the land of the Philistines is in Jeremiah chapter 47, verse 4, where he tells us that he is going to spoil the Philistines from this land at this time. In this prophecy, he is referring to the scattered descendants of Israel as being like the uncircumcised Philistines. After telling us that he is going to spoil you, he tells us that boldness is going to be upon Gaza, paralleling his other prophecies that tell us that he is going to make you bald at this time, including the one I just read to you here in Amos chapter 8. He is going to show you that you are not under his covering because you are like a bunch of uncircumcised Philistines and Gazans and Ethiopians before his faces. Your umbrella is not going to cover you, just like it has kept the rain of his word from falling upon you. His prophecies referred to you as a whole bunch of other heathen nations throughout them as well. The three bowls that are on each side of his golden candlestick and the four bowls that are also part of this candlestick were made to look like almonds with knops and blossoms upon them. This is recorded in Exodus chapter 25. And the six branches, or the six reeds, shall go out from the sides of it, three reeds of the candlestick from one side and 3 reeds of the candlestick from the second side. 3 bowls fashioned as almonds or fashioned as watchings with a knop and a blossom on one reed, and 3 bowls fashioned as almonds with a knop and a blossom on one reed, so that there are 6 reeds that go out from the candlestick. And in the candlestick, the candlestick shall have 4 bowls fashioned as almonds with knops and blossoms. Is it a coincidence that there are we are now nearing the end of the 6th year from when the Most High plucked me from your midst by sending me to Greece in fulfillment of his Ezekiel chapter 12 end time son of Adam prophecy? The Hebrew word for fashion as almonds is the same exact verb that means to watch. It comes from a word that means an almond. I can assure you that it is not a coincidence that Aaron's rod budded forth almonds at the time of Korah's rebellion, when the Most High used doing so to testify that he and his brother Moses were his servants. Nor is it a coincidence that the Most High's word testifies that he has caused me to be his end time watchman. One of the places that his word calls his end time son of Adam his watchman is in Ezekiel chapter 33, that contains the verses that I read to you a bit ago, that tells us that you will listen with your ears, but you will not do that which you have heard. And this has come to pass. His altar has 4 bowls that light it. His altar that he's reared up in the midst of Egypt at this time has 4 bowls that light it each night, that are on the 4 corners of the 3-cubit by 3-cubit apron that encompasses the boulder design of his altar. His word calls the 20-cubit by 20-cubit border of this apron the border of his palace. I suppose that it is just a coincidence that there are 4 bowls that light his palace each night with olive oil. I started doing so long before he showed me this parallel. Back to his Amos prophecy in chapter 9, I saw Adonai stood up upon his altar, and he said, smite the knot, and shake the basins, and grab their head, all of them. And I will slay the last of them with the sword, and he that flees of them will not get fled, and he that slips away of them will not escape. Since he clearly associates the Hebrew word for knop with the almond shapes of the bowls that light his golden candlestick, and since his 2 witnesses are standing upon each side of his golden candlestick, this knop in this prophecy being given to us in its singular form is referring prophetically to one of his 2 witnesses. The Most High offered up his only begotten son to be smitten in order to set up the substitution sacrifice for our transgressions. His word tells us that he was pleased to do so. However, this was back then. It was not at the time for the fulfillment of this Amos prophecy. His word testifies that his second anointed son does not have to be physically dead upon the wide pathway of Sodom and Egypt. It does so per his only begotten son's prayer / prophecy, Father, if there be any other way. This is spoken about in other videos. This is because the Most High has already established that raising his son from the dead would not cause you to obey him anyway. So there is no purpose in him doing so a second time. Instead, he has sent me to you a second time, walking in your midst naked and barefoot. You say that you believe that he resurrected his only begotten son, yet you still refuse to do that which his son spoke for us to do, just like you fail to do that which the Most High himself has spoken for us to do. Just like you failed to do that which his second anointed son has spoken for you to do. You are indeed stiff-necked and obstinate. Yahweh has given his second anointed son over to you to be smitten in a different way. You have smitten his servant by not sustaining me, even though the Most High commanded you to do so. However, your failure to do so has not put out the light that he has sent his second anointed son with, because concerning me and his only begotten son, he spoke the following in Isaiah chapter 42. Behold, I will hold up my servant, the life that I have chosen, in whom I delight in, and I will give my spirit upon him, referring to his 7 spirits, the golden oil that flows out from the 7 lamps of his golden lampstand. and I will send him forth to judge the heathens. Those who are outside, this is a word that literally means separated by a wall. Therefore, at this time, it is referring to being outside of the 144 cubit tall wall that he has placed around the place that he has chosen for his name to dwell here. Those who are outside will not listen to his voice, nor to his cry, nor lift him up. My reed, this is a reference to one of the two reeds that each have three reeds coming out from on his golden candlestick that his golden oil pours out upon, therefore is a reference to each of his two witnesses, will be oppressed, but not broken. They will dim his wick, but it will not be quenched. I will send him forth with the truth, referring to Wickedway's word, to judge them. Our ancestors killed his only begotten son, but they were not able to keep him in the grave. As a foreshadow of this prophecy, they were not able to quench the light that his father sent him with. Nor are you going to be able to quench the light that his father and my father has sent me with. You have only been allowed to oppress his chosen, but you have not broken me. My father has not allowed it. Yahweh, my Elohim, has held me up, and soon he is going to lift me up, and you are going to know that he has sent me to you. His word says so, and he is going to execute his judgment through his two anointed sons. His word says so. 1,003 sweet-smelling songs complete, and two more to go.